Commissar. A story for all ages. Some parts of it are sensible and some are just outrageous. It all takes place in Russia, a country very quaint, which I'd like to say is mythical, but unfortunately it ain't. Our hero's name is Peter, and one eventful morn, somewhere between his heart and brain, a melody was born. The song was full of love and fun and Peter's happy spirit. And though it's still in Peter's mind, if you listen, you can hear it. Peter's little song was a thing of beauty, but before he could play it, it was his official duty to get it approved by the Commissar. And you know the kind of people Commissars are. Now, the Commissar in this story is Russian, but that's just for purposes of discussion. One finds this type no matter where one lives. We call them junior executives. And the thing about these people that's such an awful pity is they forget that they are people. They're parts of a committee with committee-shaped souls and committee-shaped hearts like interchangeable auto parts. It's a shame because one by one they might invent something colorful or create something bright. That's how anything that's beautiful always gets its start. In a single human brain, in a single human heart. For no matter how small or unimportant you are, there is something inside you that can reach a star. But these people on committees, they sit there all day and they each put in a color and it comes out gray. Gray is a nice color, but not if you've ever seen orange or red or yellow or blue or green. And we've all heard the saying, which is true as well as witty, that a camel is a horse that was designed by a committee. The only reason for committees, people being what they are, is that everybody wants to be the big chief commissar, because you get to wear the uniform, you get to wear the medals, and you sit on the handlebars while everybody pedals. And at all committee meetings, people yes you when they face you, but secretly, of course, each one is hoping to replace you. And their wheels are always clicking with internal politicking, and they whisper and they chatter, but it really doesn't matter. For the Commissar is well aware that somewhere out in Delaware, there's someone up much higher whose priority is prior, and he's got his own committee. And you think he's sitting pretty, but he's subject to the whim of some committee over him, of which I'm sure that not a one of us has heard. Have you ever heard the sound of a committee in a meeting? A committee is a very strange bird. Well, Peter had to wait till 12:30 to see the Commissar's committee with his brand new tune. Then an oily voice said, "Sit down, kid, and have a cigar." 'Twas the voice of the number one chief commissar. Peter was scared, and his heart was filled with loathing, for he recognized a wolf in Commissar's clothing. And he wondered why the Bureau of New Compositions included no musicians, just lots of politicians. Then the commissar shouted, "It's the job of this committee to decide whether music is ugly or pretty. So sing your tune, Peter, in the key of F. And oh yes, sing it loud, because the whole committee's deaf." Peter faced the commissars and timidly presented the lovely little melody that he had just invented. Filled with silence. It was thick enough to slice. Then at last the chief commissar said, "That's nice." The other commissars agreed. It was practically unanimous, except for one who disagreed, the stupid ignoramus. Then the chief said, "It's wonderful. It's perfect. But..." And Peter, with tears in his eyes, said, "But what?" Said the commissar, "You've got some problems in your second movement. That's where we're going to make our first improvement. Now, don't get us wrong, Pete. We love what you wrote. But here and there, we'll just change one little note." He shouted, "I've got it. It's heaven. It's bliss. Here's how we'll change it, Petey baby. Just listen to this." The commissar said, "What do you think, Pete? Now don't be cautious." And Peter smiled weakly because he was nauseous. He said, "Well, I'll tell you, commissar, I'd like to think it over." The commissar said, "Okay, Petey, sweetie, we'll make it a bossa nova." This made Peter unhappy and sore, because he wanted his song left the way it was before. But the Commissar shouted, "This fact must be faced. We are the makers of public taste. And let's have no talk about artistic freedom. The public goes wherever we lead them. You guys ain't got no gratitude. You're all the same. You remind me of Ludwig von, what's his name? Oh yes, Beethoven. He was too sad for words when we told him his Fifth Symphony was for the birds, but we made the public holler ha-cha-cha when we changed it to Beethoven's Fifth Cha-cha-cha." Now you take this cat, Brahms, first name Johannes. He came in here and laid this lullaby on us. Man, it made you sleepy. It just had no soul till we changed it to Brahms' Lullaby Rock and Roll. P.I. Tchaikovsky came up here one day with something he called the Swan Lake Ballet. Man, what a drag. It was real bad news till we changed it to Pete Tchaikovsky's Blues. Thank you. Giuseppe Verdi, he made the scene with a grand march from Aida. He thought it was keen, but we didn't think his march was so grand, so we marched Aida into Dixieland. By now, young Peter was pounding on the floor, screaming and yelling, "No more, please, no more. I beg of you, gentlemen, let my song remain the way it was born in my heart and my brain." But the commissars were neither impressed, touched, nor moved, and they stamped Peter's music, not approved. Furthermore, the chief said, "You need time to think. So I sentence you to 30 days in the clink." So as he continued to weep and wail, they carried young Peter off to the jail. Peter was working near the prison gates. He was making Russian license plates. (laughs) 284W362. 284W363. I am in jail, but my song is still free. 284W364. 284W365. Peter whistled his song just to keep it alive. And then, by a strange coincidence, came a very happy turn of events. For just at that moment, fate winked her eye, and a little old man came wandering by. And the little man stopped as he wandered along, for he heard Peter whistling his lovely new song. Started leaping with glee, for he owned a recording company. He called his secretary and said, "Hey, Mabel, I heard a new tune that's just right for our label." And they pressed a record the very next day and sent it to the Moscow disc jockeys to play. And everyone liked the song from the start. They could tell that it came from somebody's heart. And within 3 days, the new song made the Vladivostok hit parade. It was played on all the Russian TV shows, and Siberians whistled it as they froze. Americans heard it and liked it too. Ed Sullivan offered Peter a really big shoe. So in spite of the number one chief commissar, Peter was bigger than Ringo Starr. Bigger than Brahms and Shostakovich. Bigger than Sing Along with Mitch. And Time magazine, for its music lovers, put him on 3 consecutive covers. And one day, Hedda Hopper's column began, "Has Elizabeth Taylor found a new man?" So as Peter made his license plates behind those walls of granite, his song was being sung in every corner of our planet. They gave him a gold record suitable for display, and they made Peter's birthday a national holiday. They gave him 2 weeks off from jail, and a Russian fuss was made, and 100,000 people marched in Peter's own parade. Since the big parade was all his very own, Peter marched way up in front, all alone. Next came the commissars, all in a row, with a big sign that said, "We told you so." We knew Peter's song would be a big smash hit, and we wouldn't let him change a single note of it. Then came the old man, Ivan Slobolovich, and the commissar of disc jockeys, who took his payolovich. All the commissars were marching with music and laughter, and the commissar of street cleaners was cleaning up after. That every town and city has 100 million commissars, each one with a committee. But there never was a commissar who ever touched a star. So I'd rather be like Peter than the highest commissar.